Lindsay, I wonder whether or not the economic data is going to continue to show that kind of strength, or whether or not we do start to see a little bit of a pullback given the lockdowns and some of the things that are not in play, but are starting to maybe percolate given the virus trajectory.
Well, we are looking for non-farm payrolls to rise in a range of 1 to 1.2 million. So as you mentioned, noticeably below what we saw last month, keeping the unemployment rate still elevated near that 10% level. Now, broadly speaking, this is a continued step in the right direction in terms of putting Americans back to work. However, as we saw yesterday in terms of the initial jobless claims data, we're still talking about tens of millions of Americans in a position of joblessness reliant on unemployment benefits. So when we talk about that longer-term trajectory of returning to pre-pandemic levels, that notion is still a very distant prospect. So again, steps in the right direction, however, still quite a ways to go before we can talk about a return to normal.
The continuing claims number has always been important, but there's always been a more bigger focus on the headline unemployment rate and the headline monthly jobs number. We have started to pay a lot more attention, Lindsay, to that continuing claims number as an indicator for how soft the jobs picture is. What can you tell us about whether or not that trend of elevated levels continues to stay that way? How quickly do we get back all the jobs we really lost?
Well, what we're seeing is a loss of momentum in terms of dissipating the number of Americans that are still reliant on unemployment benefits. So when we talk about that translating into the number of jobs being created, there still is a disconnect in terms of allowing the economy to reopen. Some states doing it at a faster pace. However, as we have seen a number of cases rise across the Midwest and some of the hot spots in the West and in the southern regions of the country, we've actually seen a reversal of a lot of those policies, continuing to compound the pressure on businesses, particularly small businesses, in terms of hiring or rehiring those positions. So again, the momentum starting to slow, suggesting that we could see very anemic numbers in terms of the labor market as we head into the end of the year.
Prior to the pandemic, the industry groups that we used to watch quite a bit, because they tended to be on the more volatile side with regard to creation and losses, involved hospitality and leisure, travel and leisure, restaurants, that sort of thing, also construction, healthcare, professional services. What exactly will be the strong point for the jobs picture going forward, and what could be a real laggard?
That's a very good question. And what we have seen is some of the hardest hit areas have been the service sector. And we saw this yesterday with the service industry coming out still very disappointing, with employment particularly up slightly, but still below that 50 break-even level. And we would expect that to continue to translate into a loss of activity across the service sector. As you mentioned, hospitality, leisure, these are some of the hardest hit sectors. Where we could start to see a bounce is in healthcare. We have seen an increased demand for healthcare services, and of course, that would likely translate into increased hiring if we can see some of these Americans being put back into a position of employment.
I don't hear this word tossed around a lot, but I do hear it a little more now than I have in the last several years. That is the word stagflation, this idea of lower growth but kind of rising inflation. Are we worried right now about the inflation picture? We know that the Fed is not exactly that worried, but still, it's percolating in certain places, food, energy, other parts of the market, real estate. Should we be worried about inflation right now?
Well, as you mentioned, the Fed certainly is not concerned about inflation at this point. In fact, the Fed, looking at the most recent comments from the Federal Reserve Chairman, Jerome Powell, he said essentially we have been unable to reach that 2% target for the better part of the past decade. So at this point, they're focused on keeping rates low. They're focused on not only providing neutral policy, but further stimulative policy for the economy to help prop up growth and prop up overall price momentum. So at this point, with inflation well below that 2% target, the Fed has no concern about rapidly rising prices. And in fact, even if we did start to see inflation rise, they've said now that they are willing to allow prices to run hot, meaning well above 2% for quite some time, looking at a longer term average of prices. And of course, as I mentioned, inflation has been running well below 2% for that better part of the past decade.
Lindsay, we often focus on kind of headline nominal interest rate levels. We show 10-year yields. We show 30-year long bond yields. The one thing we don't see as much these days is the real yield, right? The nominal versus real. If you inflation adjust some of those interest rates, we're actually negative right now. What are the broader implications if this sustains longer term, this idea that real interest rates, inflation adjusted rates in America, are negative?
Well, I think this is going to be the new normal. If you look at a longer term perspective in terms of a historical interest rate chart from the Fed, we've seen nothing but downward momentum in terms of monetary policy. And at this point, the Fed has told us they're not even thinking about raising rates. So at this point, rates are essentially going to be stuck at this zero lower bound for the foreseeable future. So I do think that negative real interest rates is something that the economy is going to have to grapple with for the next several years until we start to see not only emergence from the pandemic, but an emergence back towards those pre-pandemic levels. So, of course, that's going to put pressure on capital to find real returns, which, of course, at this point has been flooding into more volatile assets, i.e. equities.